Brothers and sisters, let's go ahead and get into God's word. I hope you've been blessed by the worship thus far. If you have, go ahead and comment and say, I've been blessed. I've been blessed. Amen. Go ahead and share that. Go ahead and share that right now. Listen, before I get into this word that God has given me, I want to approach the throne again, ask God's blessing on our time together today. If you would, right where you are, go ahead and let's bow for a word of prayer and then get into this word. God, we first of all say thank you for the opportunity to serve. We thank you for the fact that you woke us up again, gave us another opportunity to worship and serve you, so we give your name the praise for that. Now, God, we ask your blessings upon this word. I ask you to allow this word to be challenging, comforting, and convicting, that we all may be the better because of what has been shared through your word. Give me boldness to speak, truths that you have given me. And God, we ask that souls be saved, lives be changed, mentalities be changed from what you will have shared today. It is in Jesus' name we do pray. Everybody say amen. Amen. Grab your Bibles. Go ahead and grab your Bibles. Grab your Bibles and go to Psalm 150, Psalm 150, verse number 6. Psalm 150, verse number 6. You can turn with me, those of you all that are still using a book, and you can tap with me, those of you that are using your phones and other devices. Find Psalm 150, verse number 6. Psalm 150, verse number 6 says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. I'll say that again. It says, let everything, not some things, but it says, let everything that has breath, somebody ought to shout everything. Let everything that has breath praise ye the Lord. God has given me a different message today to share with you that I think really speaks to where we are, not only as a church, but as a nation, as a world. So from that text, let everything that has breath, I want to talk very simply from this thought. I can't breathe. You heard me right. I can't breathe. One of the best known verses in the Bible is found in Genesis 2, verse number 7. And it says, and the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground, get this, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And it says this definitive phrase, it says, and the man became a living soul. This verse sets a pattern for the rest of the Bible, where breath is often equated with life itself. In fact, brothers and sisters, it references the breath or breathing. These references are frequent in the Bible. But with every allusion in the text and in the Bible, we'll notice that every breath is attributed to God being the one who gave it to us. Can I tell you, brothers and sisters, God gave all of us this breath. That is why, brothers and sisters, the respiratory system has many distinctive designs that feature and show the very power and providence of God. Breathing also, brothers and sisters, also illustrates our human vulnerability and our complete dependence that we need God to continue to live. Can I tell you, that is the truth for all of us, brothers and sisters, that not only do we need God to look out for us on the outside, but we need God to keep breath on the inside. So, brothers and sisters, our breathing apparatus, becomes one of the more vital parts of our very life existence. Can I tell you, let me say again emphatically, every human being, every person who is a human being has within them the breath that God breathed in us back in Genesis. Also, brothers and sisters, this is what unites us with Jesus Christ himself, because he was not only God, but he was also man. And Jesus Christ, brothers and sisters, he also had this same breath in his body. But what you got to understand, brothers and sisters, is interesting that because Jesus was not a fly-by-night preacher or rabbi in that day, Jesus was not just going along with the status quo. Jesus was shaking up some stuff. Jesus was what you call a revolutionary. Jesus was a revolutionary, and it's interesting enough that this revolutionary named Jesus the Christ, the Messiah, came and messed up the plans and and the plots of the Pharisees and the scribes. And what's interesting is that they literally chose to execute Jesus, to punish Jesus by crucifixion. You must understand, brothers and sisters, that crucifixion was a Roman form of punishment. This simply meant, brothers and sisters, that the Romans had spent a significant period of years perfecting the most excruciating and painful death known to man. And what's interesting about the cross, brothers and sisters, the cross was engineered to cause self-asphyxiation. It is, brothers and sisters, it was designed to turn the body against itself. In other words, it is designed to literally make it hard, get this, for you to breathe. The way that this cross worked, the way that the cross was engineered, that the longer you hung on the cross, the harder it was to breathe. And now I know I have some theologians that are listening to me right now, and you're saying, but wait a minute, you're certainly not suggesting that Jesus was literally killed by the cross. Can I tell you, I know from a divine perspective, Jesus even said that no man takes my life. But he says, but I lay it down. But can I tell you, but Jesus was not just divine, but he was also human as well. From a human perspective, he was literally killed on the cross because he was a revolutionary. And the means of which they chose to kill him was that they made sure that he could not breathe. Can I tell you, brothers and sisters, that's interesting. Because the very people God had sent for him to send him to save were the very people that took the breath that God placed inside of him. Can I tell you, brothers and sisters, what's also interesting about this parallel is that we're living amid this pandemic. And while we're going through this pandemic, what's interesting about the coronavirus, one of the effects of those who contract the virus is that it messes up your breathing. That's why some have had to literally live on ventilators because they struggle to breathe. So let me revisit my topic just in case you thought I forgot. That my title today is I Can't Breathe. Let me tell you, I'm glad to tell you that the reason why I can't breathe is not because of this pandemic. It's not because of the coronavirus, but the reason why I can't breathe is because I'm an African-American man who lives in the United States. And by now, you already know where I'm going. I'm not having a shortness of breath and a hard time breathing because I have the virus known as corona, but I've been dealing with the virus known as racism. And brothers and sisters, can I tell you, at 36 years of age, I can't breathe. Because for the last 400 years, my people have been oppressed. For the last 400 years, racism has literally strangled and choked my people. They hung my ancestors, and now they're kneeling on my brothers' necks. Can I tell you, brothers and sisters, I can't breathe. Why can't you breathe, Pastor Trey? I can't breathe Because as African Americans in these yet to be United States, we can't live hashtag Freddie Gray. We can't go bird watching in Central Park hashtag Christian Cooper. We can't even go jogging in Brunswick, Georgia hashtag Ahmaud Arbery. We can't relax in the comfort of our own homes hashtag Breonna Taylor. We can't play cops and robbers in the park, hashtag Tamir Rice. We can't go to church, hashtag the Charleston Nine. We can't even walk home with some Arizona iced tea and Skittles, hashtag Trayvon Martin. We can't sell CDs, hashtag Alton Sterling. And last but certainly not least, we can't even be arrested by those who are sworn to protect and serve without us having to yell out, we can't breathe. Hashtag Eric Garner. Hashtag George Floyd. Can I tell you why I can't breathe, brothers and sisters? As a black man, I cannot breathe because I live in a country where I have to say Black Lives Matter. When the truth is, when God created all of us, he gave all of us the same breath, which means we all the same. That simply means, brothers and sisters, that no matter which ethnicity we are born as, God says we all have the same breath. Can I tell you, I'm struggling, brothers and sisters, as I look at what's going on in our world, and the truth is, racism is not becoming more prevalent, brothers and sisters, it's just being filmed more. Can I tell you, when I was struggling with what God wanted me to share today, God sent me to the last words of the psalmist, because the book of Psalms is literally interesting because it has literal five books. And each of those five books, at the conclusion of every book, there is what is called a type of doxology. What's interesting, that Psalm 150 is a type of doxology for the fifth and final book of the book of Psalms. Can I tell you, brothers and sisters, I was struggling when God said, tell my people, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. I said, God, how can I tell them this when I myself feel like I can't breathe? Feel like I'm having a shortness of breath, not because of the virus of corona, but I'm struggling with racism as an African-American male. What's interesting, brothers and sisters, is that the last words of Eric Garner, and more currently, the last words of George Floyd simply say, I can't breathe. For 8 minutes and 46 seconds, they kneeled on George Floyd's neck. But what's also troubling for me is that the last words of the psalmist says, let everything that has breath. Wait a minute, God. How can I heed the words and the last words of the psalmist and also hear the last words of my fellow brothers? Can I tell you, somebody here who's listening to me right now, you have that same struggle because you have the challenge of feeling suffocated and feel like you literally can't breathe. And somebody's saying, Pastor Trey, well, the social injustice is choking me. Yes, and yes, I'm struggling during this pandemic, but Pastor Trey, if I'm honest, it's not just that's causing it, making it hard for me to breathe. Because the truth of the matter is, while all of this other stuff is going on, life is still happening. My children are still acting up. My family is still falling apart. And so, Pastor, yes, I stand with Black Lives Matter. Yes, I'm still trying to wear my mask, but my life didn't stop happening. 2020 has been one of those years. Am I talking to somebody right now who's saying this year you started off with a resolution and now you feel like you hit rock bottom? Come on, talk to me today. Am I talking to somebody who feels as though that life has a way, racism has a way, this pandemic has a way of literally restricting your breath? And you're like me, God, how can I let everything that has breath? How can I heed what you said in your word when how I feel? What I love this, brothers and sisters, is that Psalm 150 contains no argument, no real teaching, no real explanation. It is an eloquent, passionate cry, get this, for all of creation to give Yahweh the praise that is due him. Wait a minute, God. You're saying that even when I feel like I feel, even when I have a shortness of breath from a mental and a social and a spiritual perspective, God, you're still trying to tell me I owe you praise? He said, Pastor Trey, yes, you still owe me prayers. I said, God, why? I don't feel like it. He said, that's your problem. Because you keep making the mistake of thinking that praise is about how you feel. But whenever you praise me, that whenever you give me glory, it's not about how you feel about what's going on. It's really about how you feel about me. And so he simply said to me, Trey, am I only good when the news cycle is not what it is right now? Am I only good when there's no pandemic going on around? And God forced me to say to you, he said to me, and also I'm saying to you, that God is still good no matter how bad things feel right now. Can I tell you, brothers and sisters, I love how Alexander McLaren says this. He says that this psalm, while it lacks theological terms, it literally is the testimony of a life that is committed and devoted to God. He says that at the end of the day, you still have to have a praise that's not about what you have and not about what's going on around you, but a praise that transcends all of that, that God is still good. But I love this, brothers and sisters, because when we look at this text in a very careful way, the psalmist is saying to us, despite how you may feel, he says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. What you first need to understand about this text is that these words, if you read it clearly, you'll discover what the psalmist is actually doing. He is actually extending an invitation. He's extending an invitation. In the final lines of this final psalm, he issues this invitation. He's saying, let everything that is breathing, that has the capability of drawing from God's air, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Who is the invitation to? Who is the psalmist talking to, brothers and sisters? Who is he saying, I'm inviting you, I'm encouraging you, I'm admonishing you to give God praise? Here's the answer. It's in the text. It says, those who can breathe. Can I tell you, I may be struggling to breathe. We may be struggling to breathe. But if you can hear my voice, can I tell you, we may be struggling to breathe as a people, but we still have breath. I wish I had some help right there. We still have breath. And I don't care how limited we may feel in that regard. The Bible still invites us to let everything that has breath praise the Lord. So if, brothers and sisters, this is an invitation to praise him, then that simply means that praising God or not is our choice. Can I tell you? You have to choose to praise God. You have to make a conscious decision in your life. You have to say, despite what kind of day I am having, what kind of week I am having, what kind of year I am having, I will bless the Lord. I'm convinced that that's why David says these personal statements as he's writing these psalms. Because can I tell you, sometimes it's so hard to praise God when you feel so much pain on the outside and so much pain on the inside. But can I tell you that when you have a personal praise, you discover that no matter how bad things are, you can always find a reason to give God praise. Can I tell you, brothers and sisters, that I know that times are rough. 2020 has been one crazy year. We lost Kobe Bryant in January. Then the pandemic started in February. And now this social injustice that's been going on in our country, now it's even becoming more prevalent during the pandemic. Can I tell you, we're struggling to breathe, but can I tell you, if God woke us up, if God did what he did for us, we have to make the right choice. That simply means, brothers and sisters, that you do not have permission to sideline yourself because you're not feeling well and because things are not looking good. God says you still have to make the right choice. God says that if you're gonna really be a real praiser, don't be a fair weather. You need, because see, fair weather people, they need ideal circumstances to give God praise. But real praisers, real people who are authentic followers of Jesus Christ, real people, they say, God, if you don't do anything else, you've done enough for me to praise you for the rest of my life. Would you help me preach this? Would you talk back right where you are and just type, say he's still good. Come on, go on and type it. Go on and help me type it. Say he's still good. Yeah, he's still good. Because the truth of the matter is, brothers and sisters, no matter how we feel, we still owe God praise. We still owe God praise. Can I tell you, here's the question. Well, how do we honor God? Because the truth is, somebody saying, well, how do I honor God if I have breath? Can I tell you, we have falsely interpreted this passage in liturgical terms. That is, we've only seen praise as something that we do in the sanctuary. But can I tell you, we honor God more than just what we do in the sanctuary. But it's actually even honoring God in how we live. Can I tell you? How do you honor God? When you're living through 2020 and you're grappling with this pandemic and you're also sick and tired and sick of this racial injustice that you continue to see at the hands of your brothers and sisters. Can I tell you one thing that we can honor God with? It's not just staying home being bitter, but to become participants in the process. I believe, brothers and sisters, that if we're going to honor God, it's not just how we quote scriptures. It's not just how we show up and pay our tithes. But how we impact the very world that we live in is how we honor God. We can honor God, brothers and sisters, during this time by using our voices to speak for those who don't have a voice. Can I tell you, brothers and sisters, one of the ways we can honor God during this racial climate, number one, we can involve ourselves in what is called peaceful protests. That is, that you're standing, taking a stand to disrupt the world so that we can get their attention to let them know that we are sick and tired of seeing black lives taken by those who are sworn to protect them. But not only must we protest if we're going to honor God, I believe, but we also, brothers and sisters, we also have to become a part of the political process. That is, we have to vote. I understand that historically, our people have not necessarily, within the recent years, taken the voting act and the act of voting very seriously. But can I tell you, we had ancestors that died, that literally were hung, lynched, just so we can have the right to go to the poll. Can I tell you, if you're going to honor God during this type of climate, no, it's not enough to just go on Facebook and post stuff. No, it's not enough to talk about our current president. But in the words of Barack Obama, don't boo, vote. Because God says that the faith without works is dead. So you can pray that things change, but until you become a part of the change, that's when God says, you are honoring me because you are giving a voice to the voiceless. But not only that, brothers and sisters, we've got to become productive, active members of our community. We have some other younger brothers and sisters, some other people that can be impacted. We've got to go back to the village mentality. This African proverb that it takes a village to raise a child. Can I tell you, where is our village for our children? Where is the village that's going to hold other younger parents accountable? We need to get back to our village to become parts, productive parts of our own communities. But not only this, not only can we honor God in that way, but again, brothers and sisters, in order to really become an active part of what God is doing in our lives, sometimes, brothers and sisters, we have to make the choice that we're going to be devoted to what God told us to do. Can I tell you that the way you honor God, brothers and sisters, is that you don't give up, that you don't tap out, that you don't decide to walk away from Him? Because can I tell you, there's some people watching how you're going to respond, because you shouted when God gave you the car. You shouted when God gave you the house. You shouted when God gave you a job. But there's some people who want to know, now that you're down on your luck, and now that things are not going the way that it used to go, He wants to see, and they want to see, will you still have the same testimony that you had before? Can I tell you, you kind of have the same testimony that God is still worthy of your glory, of the glory that deserved, and He's worthy of your faithfulness. Say faithfulness. He's deserving of that. But lastly, I love this. It says, He says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Can I tell you, when I first looked at this text, I discovered, when I looked at the word Lord, I originally thought it was the word Jehovah. That is part of the compound names of God. We're going to talk about that next week, next Sunday at the drive-in. But I thought it was that word, but it's not that word. It's actually the word Yahweh. Yahweh is a direct term that references God and the God of Israel. Y'all don't know when to get happy. It says, praise the Lord, praise the God of Israel. Why should I shout that, Pastor Trey? Well, you know that Israel were a hard-headed people. Israel did not always do what God told them to do. But what He says, praise the God who believes and given second chances. Can I tell you, I'm so grateful. I don't know about you, but I'm grateful that I serve a God who really, I got it wrong. He's not the God of second chances, but He's the God of another chance. I'm one of the anybody that came to worship today that can testify He is the God. As a matter of fact, you wouldn't be on here right now if He didn't give you another chance. He's the God of Israel. But I love this, because Israel went through slavery. Israel went through slavery. After He brought them out of that slavery, He raised up a David who would lead them. He raised up David, and David slayed a Goliath. David reestablished Israel as a powerful nation. And even once that nation fell, I'm so glad that God was always the God of Israel, because even after they failed themselves, He still let a virgin give birth to a baby who came from the house of Israel, and His name is Jesus. And can I tell you that even after they took His breath, the Bible says early Sunday morning, He got up with all power in His hands. He hung on the cross longer than 8 minutes and 46 seconds. Bible says he hung on that cross from the 6th to the 9th hour, literally from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. He hung on there for hours. But I'm so glad that's not how the story ends. Because on the third day morning, He got up with all power in His hand. What are you saying, Pastor Trey? All I'm trying to tell you is that if He's the God of Israel, He's the God of us. I love what my favorite hymn, my favorite song, the Black National Anthem says. I love what James Weldon Johnson says. He says, God of our weary years, God of our silent tears. Thou who has brought us along the way. Can I tell you, brothers and sisters, he's still our God. He's the God of the people who are oppressed. He is the God of those whose lives are taken at a disproportionate rate. He is the God of those who don't have a voice. He is the God of those where the majority is in control of their faith. He is the God of those whose neighborhood have been marginalized and they have literally quarantined us into poverty. He's the God of us. And can I tell you, the same God that looked out for Israel, the same God that brought them all the way and literally led them to Jesus, that same God is our God. Can I tell you, child of God, that if that is the same God, which it is, that only leads me to one truth, that when life feels like it's out of control, the good news is God is in control. Can I tell you, brothers and sisters, I want to leave you with this. I don't care what's going on around us. We can't forget that we have somebody who's looking out for us. I'll close like this, brothers and sisters. A friend of mine told of a story about he had a few people who had problems with him in his class. And so what these group of boys had decided to do, they decided that they were going to jump on him. They knew he had no older brother. They knew he had no older cousins that went to the school. So they thought, we're going to get the best of him now. So they followed him home. It was a little dark by this time. They followed him home and they literally followed him talking and telling him what they were going to do to him. They were threatening him. They were throwing stuff at him. He kept on walking. And then he got to the driveway of his house. And brothers and sisters, the little boy had all he could take. He said, enough is enough. Maybe that's exactly where you are. You're saying enough is enough. I'm tired. I'm sick of being sick. I'm tired of being tired. And he said, enough is enough. And he turned to face these four or five boys. And as the story went on, they all were sizing up. They all were getting ready to fight. So at once, the boys stopped and froze in their steps. And when they were getting ready to make a step, they stopped. And this scared look came over their face. They ran, and they didn't even touch the boy. I know you're asking, what happened? Did the boy pull out something? No, he didn't pull out anything. He was just carrying his book bag. But what happened when my friend turned around? He turned around and saw his daddy standing in the doorway with a shotgun. And he already knew that that was his daddy's way of telling the boys and the threats against him, you can't have my child. I'll see you next time, brothers and sisters. But can I tell you, that's the word for you. God is saying that they can't have us because we belong to him. And if we are a child of God, the Bible is still true that he simply says that if you are my child, touch not mine anointed, do my prophet no harm. Brothers and sisters, I want to encourage you. As we're going through these challenging times, I know you feel like you can't breathe. But God says, if I woke you up, it's an invitation that you still owe me praise and you still need to honor me. Would you bow with me as we get ready to go? I'm going to go ahead and pray us out. I hope that this word was a blessing. Was this word a blessing for you today? If it was, would you go ahead and type that in? Type that in now. If this word was a blessing to you today, I hope already you've already shared this. But if you haven't already, go ahead at the conclusion of this, share this video with as many people. I believe this is a message that God had. This is a rhema word that God speaks to us in our relevant moments. Can I tell you, listen, if you want to be a blessing to somebody, share this video, share this worship experience. And I believe we're going to be the better because of what we heard today. If you were blessed today, go ahead and type that. Listen, let's go to God in prayer. What I want you to do again, I want you to join me. We're going to pray our way out. Would you go ahead and touch the screen right where you are? Go ahead and touch the screen. And I'm believing that God's going to bless us and make us better. And can I tell you, I'm going to say this again, this too shall pass. As rough as things are in 2020, it didn't come to stay. It's going to come to pass. Let's pray together. God, we first of all thank you that you are the God of the oppressed. We thank you that you are the God of those who you love, and you are the God of another chance. Thank you, God, for how you have kept our people, that despite the social injustice of our country, God, for these yet to be United States, God, thank you that you allowed our ancestors not to give up in those fields as they were working for free as slaves. Thank you, God, that you let us make it to civil rights and let us see a Barack Hussein Obama become president. And now, God, for the future, we know that you are still having your hand active. And though we don't understand, your ways are not our ways, and your thoughts are not our thoughts. And God, for that, we give your name the praise. And so, God, when we can't trace you in this season, help us to trust you. Help us to trust your voice. God, as we prepare to close this worship, for my brother and sister that is struggling to breathe, for all of us that are struggling to breathe, God, give us our second wind. Give us our second wind, that we may be better servants. And God, help us to honor you, not just in the sanctuary, but even outside, in how we use our voices for the voiceless. It's in Jesus' name we do pray. Everybody say amen. If you receive that, type amen. Type amen. Listen, brothers and sisters, it has been a joy to worship with you. I hope something was said today that blessed you today. Listen, I cannot wait to see you at the drive-in service. But as we always say in the words of Reverend Lula Payne, I love you and ain't nothing you can do about it.